Good morning, my dear children. Today we will finish the third chapter of your history book, The Delhi Sultans. Let's begin a closer look, administration and consolidation under the Khaljis and Tughlaqs. The consolidation of a kingdom as vast as the Delhi Sultanate needed reliable governors. So they needed somebody who was like on whom they can rely. And for that, for the like administration purpose, so instead of appointing governors from the aristocratic family or from the chieftains, they prefer to appoint the slaves whom they have purchased, and were called as bandigan. The word bandigan has been taken from Persian. So governors and administrators, rather than appointing aristocrats and landed chieftains as governors, the early sultans, especially Iltutmish, favored their special slaves purchased for military service called bandigan in Persian. They were carefully trained to man some of the most important political offices in the kingdom. Since they were totally dependent upon their master, the sultan could trust and rely upon them. So they were purchased by them, and these slaves were completely dependent on their masters, so sultans could rely on them, at times they were more comfortable with them than their sons even. So slaves rather than sons. The son sultan advised a slave whom one has brought up. So whom one has brought up and promoted must be looked after for its need as a whole lifetime, needs a whole lifetime and good luck to find a worthy and experienced slave. Wise men have said that a worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. Can you think of any reason why a slave would be better than a son? So this is the reason why, because a slave is completely dependent on the ruler, so they could easily rely on them. The Khaljis and Tughlaqs continued to use bandigan and also raised people of humble birth who were often their clients to high political position. They were appointed as generals and governors. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. Slaves and clients were loyal to their masters and patrons, but not to their heirs. So slaves, one drawback with them was that they were loyal to their masters, but then it was not necessary that they will be loyal to their son also, to the master's son or whoever is ascending him afterwards. New sultans had their own servants. As a result, the accession of a new monarch often saw conflict between the old and the new nobility. The patronage of these humble people by the Delhi Sultan also shocked many elites, and the authors of Persian Tawarikh criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and base-born to high offices. So when a new person ascended the throne, he had his own set of slaves, so they didn't need the slaves who were of their father or maybe some relative. And the when you talk about the slaves, they were also more loyal to the ones who have bought them and not to the person who has ascended the throne after him. So and people who have written these, writers of the Tawarikh, they have criticized these, habit or this work of the Delhi Sultans. Officials of Delhi of Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq. Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq appointed Aziz Khumar, who was a wine distiller, Feroz Hajam, a barber, Manka Tabak, a cook, and two gardeners, Ladha and Pira, to high administrative post. Ziauddin Birni, a mid-14th century chronicler, reported their appointment as a sign of the Sultan's loss of political judgment and his incapacity to rule. Just because they were from humble origin, these chroniclers, they have shown their disliking towards the Sultans. Like the earlier Sultan, the Khalji and Tughlaq monarch appointed military commanders as governors of territories of varying sizes. These lands were called Ikta, and their holder were called Iktadar or Mukti. The duty of Mukti was to lead military campaign and maintain law and order in their Iktas. In exchange for their military services, the Muktis collected the revenue of their assignments as salary. So the task of Mukti was to lead military campaign, that is the first military campaign, then maintaining law and order in their Iktas. And for this, in exchange of this military service, what they got was that they could collect the revenues of their assignment as salary. They paid their soldiers from these revenues. Control over Mukti was most effective if their office was not inheritable and if they were assigned Iktas for a short period of time before being shifted. So from this you can make out that these Muktis were not permanently appointed, like they could be shifted from one Ikta to another. So now you can understand, like, so that they cannot become very important at one place. So control over Mukti was effective. And secondly, it was not inheritable. That means it will not pass on from father to son. And these harsh conditions of service were rigorously imposed during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq. Accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the Muktis. Care was taken that the Mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the state and that he kept the revenue number of soldiers. So these people had to collect the revenue, and they had to collect only the prescribed amount which was prescribed by the state. For that, these accountants were there who kept a check on them that they are collecting that much tax only. Then they had to maintain a required number of soldiers in their army so that they could provide military support whenever was needed. As Delhi Sultan brought the hinterland of the cities under their control, they forced the landed chieftains, that is the Samanta aristocrats and rich landlords, to accept their authority. Under Alauddin Khilji, the state brought the assessment and collection of land revenue under its own control. The rights of the local chieftains to levy taxes were cancelled and they were also forced to pay taxes. The Sultan's administrators measured the land and kept careful accounts. Some of the old chieftains and landlords served the Sultanate as revenue collectors and assessors. There were three types of taxes, that is the cultivation tax called Kharaj and amounting to about 50% of the peasant's produce. Then the tax on the cattle and on houses. It is important to remember that large part of the subcontinent remained outside the control of Delhi Sultan. It was difficult to control distant provinces like Bengal from Delhi, and soon after annexing southern India, the entire region became independent. Even in the Gangetic Plain, there were forested areas that Sultanate forces could not penetrate. Local chieftains established their rule in these regions. Sometimes rulers like Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq could force control, their control in these areas, but only for short duration. So these were far off lands or the forest area where they did not have control. Muhammad Tughlaq and Alauddin Khilji, they tried, and for some time they could have control, but later on it was difficult to maintain them, and so these places or these people, they declared their independence. Ibn Battuta, a 14th century traveler from Morocco, Africa, explained that chieftains sometimes fortified themselves in mountains, in rocky, uneven and rugged, not hollow. Its several parts are so intertwined that even fire cannot affect them, and they are on the whole very strong. The chieftains had lived in these forests which served them as ramparts, inside which are their cattle and their crops. there is also water for them within. That is rainwater which collects there, hence they cannot be subdued except by powerful armies who entering these forests cut down the bamboos with specially prepared instruments. So what they did was that they fortified themselves in the areas where there were mountains, uneven lands, and or in the bamboo groves. So bamboo is like something which is hollow, obviously you know it, it is hollow from inside and it is big. So its several parts are so intertwined that like how it is made in such a way that it's just like, you know, it is said that even fire, according to him, he said that even fire cannot affect them, and they are very strong. What they did was they lived in these forests in which they has these like inside there they had their cattle, their crops, and there was water also for, so they could survive. They could have cattle, they had their own cattle, their crops, they could survive there. There is also water for within, so they cannot be subdued except by powerful armies. The Mongols under Genghis Khan invaded Transoxian for northeast Iran in 1219, and the Delhi Sultanate faced their onslaught soon after. Mongol attacks on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq's rule. This forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi, which posed a huge administrative challenge. Let us see how two sultans dealt with it. So you can see that they have made a table. Alauddin Khilji, Delhi was attacked twice between 1299 to 1300 and 1302 to 1303. And as a defensive measure, he raised a standing army. What Muhammad Tughlaq did was, he was attacked in the early years, and the Mongol army, army was defeated. Muhammad Tughlaq was confident that the strength of his army and his resources to plan the attack on Transoxiana. He therefore raised a large standing army. So you can see both of them had large standing army. Alauddin constructed a new garrison town named Siri for his soldiers, while Muhammad Tughlaq constructing a new garrison town, the oldest of the four cities of Delhi, Delhi-e-Kohna, was emptied of its residents and the soldiers garrisoned there. The residents of the old city were sent to new capital of Daulatabad in the south. So he completely vacated, asked the place to be vacated, and there the soldiers lived. And Alauddin Khilji had a place, he had a garrison town named Siri. The soldiers had to be fed. This was done through the produce collected as tax from lands between Ganga and Yamuna, and tax was fixed at 50%, we have read it before. Here, produce from same area was collected as tax to feed the army, but to meet the expense of maintaining such a large army of soldiers, the Sultan levied additional tax. This coincided with famine in the area. So that was at that time the famine had struck the place. Here the soldiers had to be paid. Alauddin chose to pay his soldiers salaries in cash rather than ikhtas. The soldiers would buy their supplies from merchants in Delhi, and it was thus feared that merchants would raise the prices. To stop this, he had introduced the market control policy, where the prices of goods were fixed, and it was carefully surveyed that the fixed prices, things were sold on the fixed prices. And Muhammad Tughlaq paid his soldiers in cash. So you can see the similarity, both of them they paid in cash, but instead of controlling prices, he used token currency, somewhat like present day paper currency, but made out of cheap metal and gold and silver. So people, they started minting their coins at their home. And so you cannot say that idea was not good, but then the currency was like counterfeited by families at home very easily. Alauddin's administrative measure was quite successful, and chroniclers praised his reign for its cheap prices and efficient supplies of goods in the market, which successfully withstood the threat of Mongol invasion. Muhammad Tughlaq's administrative measures were a failure. His campaign into Kashmir was a disaster. He then gave up his plan to invade Transoxiana and disbanded his large army. Meanwhile, his administrative measures created complications. The shifting of people to Daulatabad was resented. The raising of taxes and famine in Ganga Yamuna belt led to widespread rebellion. And finally, the token currency had to be recalled. So whatever he did, maybe the timing was not very appropriate, or the way, like, you know, it was all considered to be a disaster. In the list of Muhammad Tughlaq's failures, we sometimes forget that for the first time in history of Sultanate, a Delhi Sultan planned a campaign to capture Mongol territory. Unlike Alauddin's defensive measure, Tughlaq's measure were conceived as part of a military offensive against the Mongols. The Sultanate in the 15th and 16th century. Take a look at Table 1 again. You will notice that after the Tughlaqs, the Sayyids and Lodi dynasty ruled from Delhi and Agra until 1526. By then, Jaunpur, Bengal, Malwa, Gujarat, Rajasthan and the entire South India had independent rulers who established flourishing states and prosperous capitals. This was also the period which saw the emergence of new ruling class groups like Afghans and Rajputs. Some of the states established in this period were small but powerful and extremely well administered. So here, after Tughlaqs, Sayyids and Lodis did get, like, you know, ruled till 1526 when the Mughals took over. But then what happened, by that time Bengal, Jaunpur, Malwa, Gujarat and Rajasthan, they had their independent rulers and they were flourishing in the, like, you know, states with their capitals. Some of the states established in this period were small but powerful and extremely well administered. Sher Shah Suri, from 1540 to 45, started his career as a manager of a small territory for his uncle in Bihar and eventually challenged and defeated the Mughal Emperor Humayun. So because of him, Emperor Humayun had to escape to save his life. And from 1530 to 40 and from 55 to 56, so Sher Shah captured Delhi and established his own dynasty. But then his coming generations were not efficient, so Sohr dynasty ruled for only 15 years, that is 1540 to 55. It has introduced an administration that borrowed elements from Alauddin Khilji and made them more efficient. Sher Shah's administration became the model followed by great Emperor Akbar, 1556 to 1605, when he consolidated the Mughal Empire. So even Akbar had taken ideas from the administration of Sher Shah Suri. If he would have lived more, then things might would have been different in history. The idea of the three orders was first formulated in France in early 11th century. It divided society into three classes: those who prayed, those who fought, and those who tilled the lands. This division of society into three orders was supposedly supported by the church to consolidate its dominant role in the society. This helped the emergence of new warrior group called knights. So there were three classes: one who fought, that is the armies, like soldiers; one who tilled the lands; and one who prayed. The church patronized this group and used them to propagate their idea of peace of God. Their attempt was to direct warriors away from the conflict amongst themselves and send them instead on a campaign against the Muslims who had captured the city of Jerusalem. This led to a series of campaigns called the Crusaders. These campaigns in the service of God and the church completely altered the status of knights. Originally, these knights did not belong to the class of nobles. But by the end of the 11th century in France and a century later in Germany, the humble origin of these warriors were forgotten. By the 12th century, nobles also wanted to be known as knights. So, Like by that time, this like you know, those who were known as knight, they were given a lot of respect. So with this we end the chapter. Please do the question answers. Do read the chapter and underline the important things of the chapter. Take care of yourselves. Be safe at home, children. Thank you.